Welcome to Applied Mathematical Finance, Computational Finance and its Object-Oriented Implementation. We are in a session on interest rates, interest rate products, and we already started discussing the valuation of interest rate options. So the classic simple options, the Caplet, the swaption, using the Black model, the Bachelier model. But we also introduced already the Quanto Caplet. So a product that has some more unnatural payoff. And while the foreign Caplet, so that was here, pays the foreign interest rates in foreign currency, so we have here the foreign interest rate, it's multiplied with a foreign currency amount. So such that if we are a domestic investor, we value it by converting this value into our currency. So that is, as we will see later, the natural way. The Quanto pays this foreign currency in domestic currency units. So we just convert the value by arbitrarily changing the currency. We are not using the currency exchange rate. And we will see that this is actually the unnatural way, which requires, if we perform valuation, an even more advanced model. So, and actually this is a very nice example because you will see also the role of the change of Numeria technique when we discuss the valuation of the Quanto. So it's a nice example. Before we start with the valuation of the Quanto Caplet, let's shortly discuss the valuation of the foreign Caplet. So as I just mentioned, the foreign Caplet pays the foreign interest rate. So here all quantities that relate to a foreign market are marked with a tilde. Yeah, that will also be the case for the upcoming session on the Quanto. For the foreign Caplet, we pay the foreign forward rate in foreign currency, and it is converted to domestic currency at payment time. So here, important, the T2 is the payment time. So note that the payoff is given or converted to domestic currency. So the valuation of this foreign Caplet is actually already treated by our session on the domestic Caplet. So what we will do here is we will assume the same log normal dynamic, and then we will get the same valuation formula. So the corresponding log normal dynamic is assumed for the foreign forward rate. So we model it using here a Black with a Black Scholes-like model. Then the valuation follows immediately from the valuation of the domestic Caplet under the corresponding model. So we will get just a Black-Scholes formula where all the domestic quantities, like the sigma or the initial value of the L. So maybe I should add here the initial value. Yeah. Are just replaced by the corresponding foreign currency amounts. So, however, it's interesting to take a closer look because there are two alternative ways of showing this result. So one way is that we move into the foreign market and we assume that we are a foreign investor and we postulate a Black-Scholes model in this foreign market for the interest rate. And then we just get the Black-Scholes formula using all the foreign market quantities. is a valuation formula for the foreign market value of this caplet, and then we can convert this value to the domestic value. So if we would like to draw a little picture, so here is the foreign market, and here is the domestic market. Then the caplet pays, say, at time T2. So there is some payment here. Then we value this payment to evaluation time. And then we convert this value to the domestic market using the conversion rate at evaluation time. So that's one possible approach. And you see, since we have here the same conditions, we just get the same formula with a conversion FX conversion rate. Another alternative is to convert the stochastic payment using the future, so stochastic currency conversion rate, to the equivalent value in my domestic market, and then value this using my domestic market numeraire. Okay, so that's an alternative way. So here you take expectation using a domestic market numeraire, while below you take expectation using a foreign market numeraire. And what you get is here the foreign value to then calculate the value in domestic currency. Okay, so you see two alternative ways, depending on where you perform the risk neutral valuation. So the first approach, this is taking the view as a foreign investor and move into the foreign market. So then we will take a look at the payoff in foreign currency. Then we get under the assumed model. So for example, in our case, under Black-Scholes model, a foreign valuation formula where all the domestic quantities are replaced by the corresponding foreign market quantities. Then the domestic investor can buy this foreign caplet at the price corresponding to the foreign value converted to domestic currency at evaluation time. So we convert it at evaluation time. So that's the first approach, yeah, the lower one in my little picture. Alternative approach is that we assume that we are a domestic investor. And maybe this is, from a mathematical point of view, the cleaner approach, because we are a domestic investor. So we value the product as a domestic investor. So that means all cash flows created by the product are converted using the currency exchange rate at payment time of the cash flow. Then, if we are a domestic investor, we have to choose a domestic investor numeraire. Okay, and if you look, the numeraire is associated with when it is paid. No, for the caplet, it was when it is paid. Yeah, what is paid is actually one unit of foreign currency. So the numeraire associated with this amount here is the foreign bond, the foreign zero coupon bond at payment time converted to domestic currency. And now we see that we have, like in the derivation of Black-Scholes formula for the Kaplet, the same property that the index that is paid is a martingale under this numerator, is a QPT2 times FX martingale. Okay, so why is that? How do we see that? Okay, if you take the foreign forward rate, well, this is the interest rate associated with the foreign zero coupon bond. So it's the bond at the beginning minus the bond at the end of the period divided by the bond at the end of the period. All these guys observed in the foreign market, so foreign currency zero coupon bonds divided by the period length. So it's this object. Yeah, but now I can add a currency exchange rate to the top and the bottom. So this is a portfolio which I can convert to domestic currency. And here too. Okay, that does not change the expression, but you see that on top you have the portfolio of a traded asset. Foreign bonds converted to domestic currency. And on the bottom, you have your numerator, the foreign bond in domestic currency. So this is a martingale. So choosing that numerator, you then arrive at the same probability distribution for this index. And if you take expectation of now L tilde, you will get the same Black-Scholes formula, just with that different numerator. So you will get with both approaches this formula. So you see, if you take the second approach, there appears here this numerator, the bond that pays 1 unit in T2 in foreign currency, so the foreign zero coupon bond converted to domestic currency, so that is our numerator. And we also observe the index here, the initial value of our interest rate. And of course, there is also here the index and the volatility related to this index appearing in this D plus minus. That is the formula that we get. And this is as if we would take the foreign currency Kaplet in the foreign market and convert it to the domestic currency at evaluation time. So that's the first approach. Okay, so that was the valuation of the foreign Kaplet viewed from a domestic point of view. So now let's take a look at the quantum Kaplet. So the quantum Kaplet has the same payoff function with a small modification. We do not use the currency conversion rate here. So we just pay the foreign interest rate in domestic currency. So compare this with the Kaplet. For the Kaplet, there was here the FX. And well, at first the Kaplet looked much more complicated. It looked a little bit as if we would have to model two stochastic quantity, the future interest rate and the future currency conversion rate. But in the expectation, the currency conversion dropped out, yeah, because we just have chosen the numerator accordingly. If we are now looking at the quanto, this nice feature that the FX drops out if we choose this numerator is missing, because this term is no longer canceling. So we pay here the foreign interest rate actually in the wrong unit. So if you consider the valuation as we did for the foreign caplet, well, this part of the numerator is equal to 1. And this part of the numerator was for the foreign caplet, it was canceling with the payment. And now it's no longer canceling. So this means if we choose the same guy as numerator as before, we actually have two different stochastic quantities in the expectation operator. We have the L and the fx, 1 divided by fx, in the expectation operator. So this product is more complicated than the foreign caplet. I take the same model. So my model is, I assume, a log normal dynamic for the foreign forward rate. So we have the same model. And now the question is, how do we choose the numerator? So if we choose the foreign zero coupon bond converted to domestic currency, so the one which was the nice numerator for the foreign caplet, then of course we have a nice property for the index, because then the index is a martingale. Okay, and this is the argument which I just had on the slide. You write down the definition of the forward rate, and then you can just multiply every quantity here in the numerator and denominator with fx, so that doesn't change anything. And you see that you have a portfolio of traded assets divided by the numerator. So this guy is a martingale. So this means that the foreign bond converted to domestic currency appears to be a good numerator with respect to properties of the index. But then if we go back to the other slide, if we look at the valuation formula, the pseudonumerator is maybe a different one. Maybe I would like to use the domestic zero coupon bond, because what we are paying is one foreign currency multiplied with one domestic divided by one foreign. So what we are doing is we pay in units of domestic currency, but if you also consider the payment time, we pay in units of PT2. So what I would like to have here is maybe just PT2 as my numerator. So PT2 evaluated in T2, which is one unit of domestic currency. Yeah, and then there will be one unit of domestic currency here. So from the expectation, it is motivated that we choose PET2 as our numeria. Well, but if you look here, it appears that likely L tilde is not a martingale under this numeria. Okay, so I do not see that this is a traded portfolio divided by the domestic bond. Yeah, so there is no domestic bond occurring here. Well, maybe one other remark, why not choosing the foreign zero coupon bond as a numeria? Because you see, if I choose the foreign zero coupon bond, then this is a portfolio of foreign bonds divided by my numeria. Yeah, it is a martingale under QP tilde, sure. And here I just have an object that is one unit of foreign currency. So QP tilde seems to be the right measure. So why not choose that? Well, the foreign bond is not a traded asset. Okay, so what? Why is the foreign bond not a traded asset? Well, the foreign bond is not a traded asset because I am a domestic investor. And as a domestic investor, if I would like to buy the foreign bond, I have to buy it in my currency. So I have to pay the price in my currency. So the traded asset is the foreign bond converted to domestic currency. So although if you move to the foreign market and if you place yourself as a foreign investor, then you will observe that L tilde is a martingale under QP tilde, and you can choose P tilde as a numeria. But if you are a domestic investor, you cannot do that. So what we can do is we can choose here the foreign bond converted to domestic currency as a numeria. It will then be L tilde a martingale. Or we can choose alternatively the domestic zero coupon bond, which is a traded asset for us as a domestic investor. But then, unfortunately, L tilde is likely not a martingale. So you see, the nice thing here with the quantum caplet is that actually this coincidence that the choice of numeria had two beneficial properties, the index becomes a martingale and the numeria vanishes in the expectation, this is lost. So one of the two properties is lost, and by the choice of numeria, we can actually choose which one we sacrifice. Do we sacrifice the nice representation under the expectation operator, or do we sacrifice that we immediately know the dynamic of the stochastic process? Okay, so I would like to have the stuff in the expectation operator look nicely. So what I will do is I will choose the domestic zero coupon bond as my numeria. So this one is one at payment time, and it will then not show up in the expectation operator above. So it is the one that fits here to the payment of the index. So I pay in one domestic currency unit. And the only thing that then appears in the expectation operator is the maximum function applied to the index, index minus k, the index L tilde. Problem is that under this measure, the index has a drift. So there is a DT part in my model, because under this measure, it is not known that this guy is a martingale. So by the change of measure from, say, the natural one, QP tilde, the natural one for the foreign caplet, to the one for the quanto caplet, QPT2, we introduce a change of drift. So this is Gesanov theorem. So the question is, how do we get this change of drift? And a role plays here the change of numerea related to these two numerea. So foreign bond in domestic currency, P tilde FX, and domestic currency bond. So we just define this ratio, the ratio of the two numereas, as an object here, and this object is called the forward FX rate. So I consider here the change from the numerea foreign bond in domestic currency to domestic currency zero copper bond. So now my payment time here is capital T, so I can define that for any capital T. And I define this object, the ratio of the two, as the so-called forward FX rate. So the forward FX or FFX of capital T, so capital T is the maturity appearing in the zero copper bond, is defined as the ratio of the foreign bond in domestic currency divided by the domestic currency bond. Note that this object is unitless, so apart from 1 divided by time for the interest rate, it is similar to the interest rate. Yeah, it's just some unitless amount, because here I have 1 foreign currency, then I multiply with 1 domestic divided by 1 foreign, so I have 1 domestic currency as the unit of that numerea, of course, and I have 1 domestic currency as the unit of that numerea. So the forward FX rate, or sometimes called FX forward, is a relative price of 2 domestic traded assets, so it is dimensionless, yeah, it is unitless. Another observation, the guy is a QPT2 martingale, because I have here a traded asset for the domestic investor, and I have here a numerea, so this object is a QPT2 martingale, yeah? So also nice property. Okay, and the forward FX rate has a nice interpretation. So what is this? So consider again that you have your domestic market here. And your foreign market here. And now you would like to exchange a payment at time capital T, so here is time capital T, from a foreign currency payment, so assume this is here 1 unit of foreign currency, so assume this is here 1 unit of foreign currency, to the equivalent amount in domestic currency. So I have here K, I do not know how many units in the domestic currency I have to put against this. So K times 1 domestic currency. And now I would like to contract this. So K is the exchange rate. Yeah. How many units of domestic currency do I need to match 1 unit of foreign currency? But now I would like to fix this exchange rate K at time little t. So there is here my evaluation time little t, and I would like to fix this. So of course, this means that the foreign currency valuation, so the valuation is then, here I have one unit of foreign currency paid at capital T, so that is the zero coupon bond P tilde, this should match the valuation of the domestic currency payment, so that is the domestic bond P capital T, observed in little t, and these two should match. So if they should match, then I have to convert this payment using the FX rate at evaluation time. And the condition is then, of course, that K times PT should equal FX times P tilde. So if you divide by the domestic zero coupon bond, you get the definition of the FFX. So the K is just the FFX. So it's the foreign currency exchange rate for a future point in time. If I enter into this contract, or if I fix it at time little t, at evaluation time. And this object is our change of numeraire. So, and now I need another ingredient here in my evaluation of the quantum Kepler. Yeah, we are still here looking at the valuation of the quantum Kepler. I need the model for this change of numeraire. So what I do is I assume a log normal model for the FX forward. So the FX forward, well, I already know that it is a martingale under the measure Q PT2, so there's no drift. I just need to assume the diffusion, and I assume that it is sigma FFX times FFX DW2. So note, yeah, I didn't highlight this. I have now here a different Brownian motion compared to the one that we used for the foreign interest rate. So I label then with DW3 and DW2. Yeah, we do not have a DW1, but maybe DW1 is the one for the domestic interest rate, but it's not needed in this valuation to model this quantity. So we now have a model for our forward FX rate, which is the ratio of the two numeraires that appear here. And recall that actually what we are looking for is, I would like to know the distribution of my foreign interest rate L tilde. So that means I would like to know the stochastic process for L tilde. Well, specifically, I would like to know here the drift part, because my L tilde is no longer a martingale. So the guy that I'm interested in is here this mu. Well, I do not know how mu looks like for L tilde, and I cannot move to a numeraire where L tilde is a martingale. But I do know that L tilde times FFX is a martingale under my new numeraire. So if I multiply L tilde, which is a martingale under the natural numeraire, yeah, foreign zero coupon bond times converted to domestic currency, with the change of numeraire, then the resulting object is a martingale. So we have that L tilde times FFX is a QPT2 martingale. Okay, so let's check this. So L tilde, my foreign interest rate, yeah, so this is just the bond at the beginning minus the bond at the end divided by the bond at the end of the period divided by the period length, then multiplied with the change of numerator, so that is here the foreign bond in domestic currency divided by the domestic bond. Yeah, you see that the foreign bond disappears, the FX stays, and it's actually the portfolio of the foreign bonds converted to domestic currency, so a traded asset divided by my numerator. Okay, so that's nice. So that means I know that the drift of this object is zero. And now, since I know that also this one here is a martingale, I can just use Itô's lemma and get an equation where the mu, which I'm looking for, appears, and I can solve for this mu. So we now know the full dynamic of two stochastic processes. So we know the dynamic of L tilde times FFX is a martingale, and we know that FFX is a martingale. So that means that we can derive the dynamic of L tilde from Itô's lemma. An easy way is just to apply Itô's lemma here to the L tilde FFX and then solve for the mu. Okay, so why is that an easy way? Because we know that actually this guy here is a zero dt. Yeah, it's a martingale plus some dw. And so if I now write down the stochastic process on the right hand side, there will at some point appear the mu which we are looking for, and I can then compare coefficients if I just compare the dt parts. Yeah, let's make this calculation. So I have that d of x times y is y dx plus x dy plus dx dy. So here for my two ingredients, I have the L, there is the DL. Well, the DL is L times mu dt plus L sigma dw. Well, this is multiplied with the FFX. So I have DL times FFX, it's multiplied with the FFX. And then I have the same for DFFX, which is multiplied with the L. So the DFFX is a martingale. So that is, I have FFX L tilde sigma FFX DW2 for the L tilde times FFX. Okay. And then the cross term, our cross term is DL tilde DFFX. So that's sigma FFX times FFX sigma L times L DW2 DW3. And now let's make an assumption. So let's make the assumption that DW2 DW3, well, they are not independent, these two guys. They have some correlation, say rho dt, rho of t dt. So I have the assumption that there is some instantaneous correlation between the two, such that I get an additional dt term. So I get here an additional dt term, which is rho sigma FFX sigma L. Of course, both is multiplied with FFX and L, so I can move the FFX and L in front. This appears here in every part. So I can move this in front. And now I have that this trifft hier, by comparing coefficients, left-hand side, right-hand side, has to be zero. So I have that this is zero. So from that, I get finally my formula of the drift. So the drift of the fore and forward rate under the measure corresponding to the domestic Zero-Cooper bond is minus the covariance. Well, this looks like covariance, sigma rho, the covariance term, instantaneous covariance of the fore and forward rate and the change of numerator. So now we can proceed as for the derivation of the domestic caplet or foreign caplet, because now we know the stochastic process and hence I know the probability distribution of the index L tilde. So now I know the dynamics of L tilde under this numerator. So we have this additional drift term minus sigma f of x rho L tilde dt. I know that this is now log normal distributed. So instead of the minus 1/2 sigma squared, which you get if you introduce now, say, y tilde, so as we did it for the domestic caplet, which is my logarithm of the L tilde. So then you know that y tilde is normal distributed, so follows a normal dynamic, and it has here a minus 1/2 sigma squared dt, and in the end it has, of course, the sigma 3 dw3. Now it has, in addition, this term minus rho sigma L sigma ffx dt. So in addition to the minus 1/2 sigma squared, I now have here this correction factor. Yeah? So we have the integral over this here in the distribution function. So a last step that you could do is you can move this blue part inside of the logarithm. So you have here the logarithm of the initial value of L. If you move it inside to the logarithm, you multiply the initial value of L tilde with the exponential of the integral of the covariance term. And you see that now the distribution of this L tilde under this measure is just the same as for the domestic caplet or for the foreign caplet, just with a modified initial value. So you can immediately conclude that you get the same Black-Scholes formula with just a slightly modified initial value. And the modification of the initial value is just this factor here, which we call the quanto adjustment. So conclusion is that we get an adjusted Black formula, where in contrast to the Black formula for the foreign caplet, the L tilde is replaced by here L tilde multiplied with e to the minus integral rho sigma ffx sigma L tilde dt. Okay, so that was the derivation of the valuation of the quanto caplet. Nice thing we saw is that actually there was no perfect choice of the numerator. There were two possibilities. Each one had a drawback. You can derive this formula with both numerators. Either you have to work a little bit on the expectation operator, or you have to work a little bit on the distribution of L tilde.
this scheme that paying in some unnatural unit is actually a general scheme, and it will appear in different ways again and again. For example, if we pay a forward rate, not at the end of the period, but we pay it at the beginning of the period, we pay it in an unnatural time. And that is also related to a change of numerator, which is related to a similar adjustment, actually looking very similar to this one. And this scheme is called convexity adjustments. And that's something we do in the next session. So that was it for today. Thank you.